You're welcome this morning, this afternoon, in house and online, to our service of morning prayer. For those who are regular parts of the congregation, a few announcements. In a couple of weeks' time, there'll be the first of our harvest services, and it's not just Thanksgiving for harvest, but it'll be Thanksgiving for the 60th anniversary of the dedication of the new Church of the Ascension in Glass. So that'll be on Sunday the 9th of October, and that'll be at 6 p.m. The Archdeacon Venerable David Huss is speaking. A meeting of the Protestant Orphan Society, Donegal Protestant Orphan Society, is meeting on the 5th of October in Cornwall, Parish Church, Letterkenny. And for those who help with children and youth work, huge thanks to Kirsty others for putting together a Leader's Rest and Retreat Day, which has been held in the Big House in Limavady. Our service is morning prayer in Esther 4. All the words I say are in green, and the words that we say together are either in yellow or white. But we shall go through, we shall join together in worship with these greetings. Grace, mercy, and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ be with you all, and also with you. We have come together in the name of Christ to offer praise and thanksgiving, to hear and receive God's holy word, to seek the forgiveness of our sins, and to pray for the needs of the world, and by the power of the Holy Spirit we may give ourselves to the service of God. Amen. O Lord, open our lips, and our mouths will proclaim your praise. Let us worship the Lord, all praise to his name. Blessed are you, sovereign God, Creator of all, to you be glory and praise forever. You founded the earth in the beginning of the heavens, and the work of your hands. In the fullness of time you made us in your own image, and in these last days you have spoken to us in your Son, Jesus Christ, the Word made flesh. As we rejoice in the gift of your presence among us, let the light of your love always shine in our hearts, your Spirit ever renew our lives, and your praises ever be on our lips. Amen. Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Blessed be God forever. Let's stand to sing our first hymn, Amazing Grace.
Thank you.
As we do each Sunday, we begin our Sunday and our week with returning to God and his ways. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, God is faithful and just and forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Let us kneel and confess our sins to God our Father. We say together, O God, our loving Father in heaven, we confess that we have sinned against you, we have broken your commandments, we have often been selfish, and we have not loved you as we should. For these and all our sins, forgive us, we pray. Through our Lord and Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen. May the Father of all mercies cleanse you from your sins, restore you to the praise and glory of his name. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Your word is a lamp unto my feet and a light upon our path. O Lord, your word is everlasting. It stands firm forever in the heavens. Let us then receive the word of the Lord. So may the light of your presence shine into our hearts. Amen. We're going to come back to the Psalms. We'll turn first this on this occasion to Timothy. Please, thank you.
A reading from St. Paul's first letter to Timothy, chapter 6, beginning at verse 6. Of course, there is great pain in godliness combined with contentment. For we have brought nothing into the world so that we can take nothing out of it. But if we have food and clothing, we will be content with these. But those who want to be rich fall into temptation and are trapped by many senseless and harmful desires that plunge people into ruin and destruction. For the love of money is a root of all kinds of evil, and in their eagerness to be rich, some have wandered away from the faith and pierced themselves with many pains. But as for you, man of God, shun all this, pursue righteousness, godliness, faith, love, endurance, gentleness. Fight the good fight of the faith. Take hold of the eternal life to which you were called and for which you made the good confession in the presence of many witnesses. In the presence of God, who gives life to all things, and of Christ Jesus, who in his testimony before Pontius Pilate made the good confession, I charge you to keep the commandments without spot or blame until the manifestation of our Lord Jesus Christ, which he will bring about at the right time. He who is blessed and only sovereign, the King of kings, the Lord of lords. It is he alone who has immortality and dwells in the unapproachable life, light whom no one has ever seen or can see. To him be honor and eternal dominion. Amen. As for those who in the present age are rich, command them not to be haughty or to set their hopes on the uncertainty of riches, but rather on God, who richly provides us with everything for our enjoyment. They are to do good, to be rich in good works, generous and ready to share, thus storing up for themselves the treasure of a good foundation for the future, so that they may take hold of the life that really is life. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
We now return to the psalm, thank you, and we read this together. Whoever dwells in the shelter of the Most High and abides under the shadow of the Almighty shall say to the Lord, my refuge and my stronghold, my God in whom I put my trust. For he shall deliver you from the snare of the fowler and from the deadly pestilence. He shall cover you with his wings, and you shall be safe under his feathers. His faithfulness shall be your shield and buckler. You shall not be afraid of any terror by night, nor the arrow that flies by day, of the pestilence that stalks in the darkness, nor the sickness that destroys at noonday. Because they have set their love upon me, therefore will I deliver them. I will lift them up, because they know my name. They will call upon me, and I will answer them. I am with them in trouble. I will deliver them and bring them to honor. With long life will I satisfy them and show them my salvation. Amen. We come to our hymn in the place of a canticle, crown him with many crowns. So let us stand to sing. Appropriate as we come to our reading from Luke, chapter 16, beginning at verse 19. Glory to you, Lord Jesus Christ. There was a rich man who was dressed in purple and fine linen, who feasted sumptuously every day. And at his gate lay a poor man named Lazarus, covered with sores, who longed to satisfy his hunger with what fell from the rich man's table. Even the dogs would come and lick his sores. The poor man died and was carried away by the angels to be with Abraham. The rich man also died and was buried. In Hades, where he was being tormented, he looked up and saw Abraham far away with Lazarus by his side. He called out, "Father Abraham, have mercy on me, and send Lazarus to dip the tip of his finger into water and cool my tongue, for I am in agony in these flames." But Abraham said, "Child, remember that during your life you received many good things, and Lazarus in like manner evil things. But now he is comforted here, and you are in agony. Besides all this, between you and us a great chasm has been fixed, that those who might want to pass from here to you cannot do so, and no one can cross from there to us." He said, "Then, Father, I beg you to send him to my father's house, for I have five brothers, that he may warn them, so they will not also come into this place of torment." Abraham replied, "They have Moses and the prophets. They should listen to them." He said, "No, Father Abraham, but if somebody goes to them from the dead, they will repent." He said to him, "If they did not listen to Moses and the prophets, neither will they be convinced, even if someone rises from the dead." This is the gospel, the good news of Jesus Christ. Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. The collect of the word for this day. O God, from whom light rises in darkness, and from those who seek you, grant us in all our doubts and uncertainties the grace to ask you what you would have us to do, that in your light we may see light, and in your narrow path we may not stumble. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Please be seated. I pray, Lord, as we come to your word, you would give us ears to hear, eyes to see, and hearts to respond. And that you might speak with us and call us and challenge us to return to your will and to your ways. And so doing, we might walk in the way and the truth and the life. And that as we do so, we might help others to walk in your ways, Jesus, in your name. Amen. So I'm going to hopefully try and explain what it is that I feel this passage is saying to us. But I want to start with a few foundations. So you got the picture of the same cushion there, and you got the stones. We're going to start with some foundation stones. Because if these things aren't in place, then the rest of it will really not hold together. In a little while, we will say through the words of the Creed our understanding of the faith, and this is part of it. We will say, and that this is what we agree with when we say Amen at the end, on the third day he rose again and ascended into heaven. This is what we say of Jesus. And we say that he is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he'll come again to judge the living and the dead. You've said it so many times, I'm hoping you'll be able to complete it. We will also say, I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. If we do not hold these truths, then the rest of what these readings have said will make little if no sense. So I felt we had to make sure we were all on level ground. Now we can turn to our readings. And just a bit of a recap and to look at the context. Jesus is doing some teaching, and he usually does this through parables so that we can engage with the people and see a deeper truth rather than just him leading forth and just saying, I like bullet points, for example. So there is a rich man, and he lives very lavishly. We have a huge clue here, and he's wearing purple. In the time of Jesus, to wear purple meant you had to get it from crushing snails. Sorry for those who like snails, but that was the only way to get it. It was extremely expensive, so you had to be very wealthy. So think of every lavish thing you can think of and put it together, and that was kind of the cost of the purple clothes. Indeed, it was usually only emperors who were allowed and had the wealth to do that. In contrast, we have Lazarus, who is at the rich man's gate, which reminds me of all things bright and beautiful. You might remember the verse we don't sing about, the rich man, the poor man at his gate. So Lazarus is in agony. He is sick. He is not getting enough to eat. He is not getting cared for. And in contrast, we have this rich man. And then when they both pass away, the Lazarus has been taken up into heaven and into fellowship with Abraham and with God, and is now in peace. Literally, not just in peace, but peace from his illnesses and peace from all the anguish that he went through. In contrast, the rich man is now in Hades or hell, in the burning fires of hell, and he is now in agony, whereas Lazarus is in agony. And a dialogue continues between Abraham and this formerly rich man. And he wants Lazarus to dip his finger and cool his tongue, yet in life, Lazarus' sores were only cleaned and soothed by the licks of the dog. The rich man didn't see the need of the other in life when he had an opportunity. Then he says, well, if you can't do that, please send somebody to my brothers. And then it continues by saying, well, surely if you send somebody from the dead, they will come to believe. And I believe this is Jesus' barb comment back to the people of his own background, the Jews. Well, they have Moses and the prophets, and if they haven't believed them, why will somebody coming back from the dead, and who would rise from the dead? Who's the first one to rise from the dead except Jesus? And even now, we have somebody who's come back from the dead and said, look, this is what will happen, and there are many who do not believe, which is why I began with the foundation stones, the creed. Because if we don't have an understanding and at least the beginning of a faith in that, then this whole dialogue and what Paul says to Timothy will make no sense. So Jesus is teaching us to have faith in him, faith in the resurrection. We might struggle with it in understanding and trying to come to terms with it, completely get that. But this is the core of our Christian faith. And like it says elsewhere in the Bible, perhaps this might be for each of us something we work out with fear and trembling, saying, God, help me in my unbelief. But this is what God offers for us and calls us to. And so we need to take heed and respond. So now we have our reading from Timothy. And Paul is writing to Timothy and teaching him how to be a good Christian and a good Christian leader. Now, I know not all of us are in Christian leadership, but we would all like to be good Christians, followers of Christ. So what Paul recommends to Timothy, I believe, applies to all of us. So he says to be a man of God, women of God as well, and then you shall pursue righteousness, a right relationship with God, godliness, faith, love, endurance, diligence. He recognizes it as a battle of wills, and is in your own will. You will fall down, fight the good fight, take hold of the eternal life, that's that life in heaven and resurrection, that you are called for, and that you confess, that you say, I believe. And we say we believe this every time we say the creed. So we're echoing what Paul is calling Timothy to do. And he says there's great gain in godliness and contentment in it. And the phrase that we hear often at funerals, we brought nothing into this world and we take nothing out. So we hold on to a righteousness, a rightness with God. And in this life, if we have clothing and we have food, let us be grateful for what we have rather than seeking after all those things which we do not necessarily need. And then we have a contrast, one against the other. Paul says the love of money can be the root of all evil. So in pursuing money, in pursuing riches and going only after that, well, we'll be more like the rich man. Whereas if we're to be like Lazarus or Timothy, we're to pursue good things, build up treasure in heaven, and in this life be generous, ready to share, and in so doing, we are working, are living out the ways of God, storing up our treasure in heaven. So now I come to this illustration. I was wondering how might this, and an image came to mind, and it was helpful for me, and I pray it's helpful for you. Most of us cannot have failed to notice the passing of Queen Elizabeth in the United Kingdom. I think we can agree that Queen Elizabeth had a few pennies to rub together. I think we can agree that she lived on occasion with pomp, circumstances, and jewels and riches. Yet what struck me is when it came to the funeral, her crown, her earthly glory, was taken away. And I believe that she recognized that she served the King of Kings. And no matter what we have in life, we come to God as if it were naked. And so the cushion was empty. And we could be like the rich man. But one of the greatest treasures of God is not just that he calls us to back to himself through his Son, not just that he's opened the way back to us to God through his death on the cross, he's taken our punishment. So we come before God and we accept the forgiveness he's won for us on the cross, forgiven. But what we also do through the cross is when we say yes to Jesus, it is as if we've been clothed with what Jesus has done for us on the cross. And we come before God, it's as if the cross is presented to him. Because here are many readings in the Bible that I want to just take us through and remind us. And these are mainly from Paul. Remember, Paul, the reason Paul's letters are so important is that Paul was a very learned man in the scriptures and in the word of God. And God used that to teach us. So he says to the church in Corinth, therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he or she is a new creation. The old has passed away. Behold, the new has come. To the church in Galatia, I have been crucified with Christ as in have died to the old self like Jesus had. So no longer I live, but Christ who lives in me, that's that righteousness again. And the life I now live in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God who loved me and gave his life for me. Peter in his letter, but you are a chosen race, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people for his own possession, so that you may claim the excellence of him who called you out of darkness, away from God, into God's way and his marvelous light. In the letter to the church in Rome, do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewal of your mind, that by test you may discern what is the will of God, which is good and acceptable and perfect. And at the church in Colossae, for you have died. It's the early baptisms, it was full immersion, you went down under the water, you came up as you committed your life to Christ and is hidden with Christ in God. And do you not know that your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit? When we say yes to Jesus and yes to his forgiveness, Jesus gives us the gift of the Holy Spirit. Your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit within you, whom you have from God. You are not your own, for you were bought with a price, so glorify God in your body. And I am sure of this, that he or she who begins a good work, well, he, because it's Jesus, begins a good work in you, will bring it to completion on the day of Jesus Christ. The Spirit himself bears witness within our spirit that we are the children of God. And last, but by no means least, put on then, God's chosen ones, holy and beloved, we put on compassion, kindness, humility, meekness, and patience. Because when I was reflecting on this, I remembered, I was having a chat with Reverend Henry Blair before I went to Lambeth with Soma. And we were talking about many things, but one little comment stuck with me. Oh, remember the phrase in the Bible, we can take nothing out of this world. His comment was, all that we take out of this world is our character, the result of our sanctification in this life, that is becoming more Christ-like in Christ's ways, in truth, and in our life, and through our lives that others may see him. We call ourselves Christians. It was originally meant as a mockery term. oh, those people are like that Jesus who they call the Christ. Would that be said of you and me today and this week to come? So before we get to that heavenly accounting, I pray that we would build up treasures in heaven, be grateful for the things we have, but know that we cannot take them with us, but we can take much more precious treasure when we come to God. As a way of responding to this, I have a song that I'd ask you to listen to. You might like to bow your heads. You might like to open your hands as a way of saying yes to God and allow the words to speak. And may it be an opportunity for us to come before him and return to him, that is Jesus, the way, the truth, and the life. So these words as a way of meditation. Let us continue in an attitude of prayer. At the end of each of the prayers, I shall say, let us pray to the Lord. And if you can join me by saying, Lord, have mercy. Let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. Almighty and everlasting living God, we ask you to hear the prayers of your people that we offer to you now in faith. We pray for the peace of heaven that comes from God alone and God above, and for the unity of all peoples in and through and by the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, and for our salvation that we might work it out with fear and trembling in the time that is left to us here on earth. Let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. We pray for the Church of Christ, this parish of Strnaorlar and the parish of Kiltivog and the parish of Mean Glass, and the other churches, sister churches, in this Finn Valley and wider afield. We pray for our own diocese of Derry and Offaly, and at this time we particularly pray for the parish of Cornwall and Garton, Reverend David and Heather Holton. We pray for Andrew, our bishop, and John, our archbishop, and for our communion across this world, particularly the land of Burundi, but also for our brothers and sisters in Christ. We pray, Lord, especially for those for where to profess your name and to live out of a life of righteousness also means to live out a life of danger and often of fear. Be with those who are struggling in their faith, both near and far, and protect those who are children of the Most High God. Let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. We pray for the nations of the world. We pray for our own nation at this time, as we're going through challenging and difficult times, with economics and many other things weighing on us. We pray for our near neighbours in Northern Ireland. We pray that they might return soon to a functioning government, and that while we know there are many difficult challenges they face, they may be able to put aside their differences and work together for the betterment of their people. We pray for our neighbours in the United Kingdom, as they mourn the loss of their head of state, and as they continue to face the challenges that we too are facing. We pray for the European Union, of which we are part. May it be an opportunity for us to work together and to support each other. We pray particularly for the people of the Ukraine, still ongoing violence and war. But we pray for other peoples where still there is violence, in the land of your birth, in Somalia, in parts of China, particularly in the land of Iran, and in many other parts that we often do not get to hear, but that you know. We pray, Lord, that you would bring peace and good government, and the leaders in our land and in the lands across the world, and particularly the UN at this time, might seek you as the way, the truth, and the life, and the source of all wisdom. Let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. We pray for the Twin Towns and the Finn Valley and the community to which you have placed us in. May we be in this day and this week that salt to bring a flavour of God and that light to carry your hope and the hope to others, to our neighbours, to our friends and to our family. And we thank you for the many organisations, peoples and groups who seek to support each other. Through St. Vincent de Paul, through visiting, and through so many other ways, would you give strength to those who carry others and yet sometimes struggle to have strength themselves. Let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. We thank you for the good earth which you, God, have given us. Would you help us to take greater care of it and to recognize it is placed into our hands to be cared and tended, so that it may return to you in good order. Would you give us wisdom how to use the resources, not just so that the world may be good, but that the resources might be shared equally and equitably with others. And while it is a great challenge, thank you for that you have called upon us anew to take better care of the world and not just use it as a resource, as if it was there to be taken. It is there to be cherished and to be passed on to those who follow us. Let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. We pray for the aged and for the infirm, for the widow, the orphan, the sick and the suffering. We pray especially at this time for Laird, for Geoffrey and Helen, and for Pat. And in the quietness of our own hearts, there are those known to us before you, that we bring before you, who need your healing and helping touch. And for all in need, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. We pray for the poor and the oppressed, as Lazarus was, for the unemployed and the destitute, for the prisoners and the captives. May we not be blind like the rich man, but see the other and see the need, and be able to respond, whether it's in prayer or practical ways. And for all members, with all people who remember and care for them, particularly the medical staff, doctors and nurses and care assistants, the Gardaí and the Fire Brigade, and all others who are often first responders, would you particularly grant them strength in challenging and difficult situations? Let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. We bring before you the dying, that they may know your peace, and that you would speak with them, and they might help us to help them see you more clearly. We pray for those who mourn and miss loved ones, either in recent times or in times gone past. And we pray, Lord, that we might be faithful before you and entrust ourselves into you, the Lord of hope, and look forward to the day when we will share in the fullness of the resurrection. Let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. We come to the ending of the prayers. For yours is the majesty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory, now and forever. Amen. And the collect for this day. God, who in generous mercy sent the Holy Spirit upon your church in the burning fire of your love, grant that your people may be fervent in the fellowship of the gospel, that always abiding in you they may found steadfast in faith and active in service through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And we say the prayer that Jesus himself taught his followers. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. We might come back to that at the end of the service, but let's stand and reaffirm our understanding of the faith through the words of the Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who is conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He ascended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. We remain standing for our final hymn and the service today. Be Thou My Vision, as we sing of the battle we fight in life, but the glory that we look for to take hold of. Be Thou My Vision.
into the world, to walk in God's light, to rejoice in God's love, and to reflect God's glory. Be with us, Lord, as we go out into the world. May the lips that have sung your praise always speak the truth. May the ears which have heard your word listen only to what is good. And may our lives as well as our worship be always pleasing in your sight. For the glory of Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. The God of hope fill you with all joy and peace in believing. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you and remain with you always. Amen. We go in peace to love and serve the Lord. In the name of Christ. Amen. And as we go, I'll return to that song which we may like to reflect on as we go.